Okay, for this first online lesson, we're going to be talking about types of matter. At this point in your life, you guys are probably all familiar with the science vocabulary word matter, and you know that it's basically a synonym for stuff, and that anything around you that you can kind of interact with, that you can feel or touch, is an example of matter. So we have all sorts of things like water, a person, iron, air, glass, gasoline. These are all examples of everyday things around us that are made of matter. So what we need to learn for this course is that the matter that we see around us can be kind of grouped into different types. And by learning about these different types, it helps us to understand a little bit better how the world around us works and how the chemistry of the things that we know and see around us work. So what we're going to do is we're going to start with the simplest of the four types, and then we're going to move into the more complicated ones. And your goal for these is to be able to identify examples of matter as one of these types, and to be able to kind of be able to draw a model of what an example would look like at the molecular level for each one of these. So let's start with probably the simplest of the four types. An example would be iron. If you could zoom in on a piece of iron, if you could zoom in on it and actually see the particles that make up like a brick of iron, you would find out that what it is like all matter, iron is made of atoms, and in the iron, all of the atoms, all of the atoms are actually the same type. So if you went in there and you could see it, you'd see all of these atoms kind of tightly packed together because it's iron, and all of the atoms are the same type. Now, in chemistry, we call different types of atoms elements, and you can find all of the different types of atoms that we know about on the periodic table of elements. And if you could see what type it was just by looking at it, you would see that all of the atoms in an iron bar are the element iron. And so when you have an example of matter like iron bars that are made up of all of the same type of atom, then we call that type of matter an element. So it can be kind of confusing because elements used two ways in chemistry. It's used to describe a specific type of atom, but it's also used to describe the type of matter that's made up of just one type of atom. So iron is an element, and these iron bars are an element, and they're made up of iron atoms, and iron atoms, iron is an element. So it just kind of works for all three levels of this type of matter. Now, the next type of matter is not made up of just one type of atom like an element is. Elements are made up of just one type of atom, so iron bars, all iron atoms. The next type of matter is made up of two or more elements, two or more types of atoms bonded together. And so a really good example of that that you're probably familiar with is water. Water, like in this picture here, is what we call a compound. Oops, sorry, wrong thing. There we go. So the second type, the first type of matter we talked about was element, and the second type of matter that we're going to talk about is a compound. And water is a compound. And so what does that mean? It means that it's made up of two or more different elements, types of atoms bonded together. So if you could zoom in and see the particles that make up pure water, what you would see is you'd see an oxygen atom, and then bonded to that oxygen atom are two hydrogen atoms. And so the key here is that the type of matter that we call a compound is made up of these little groups of atoms that we call molecules. Always two or more different types of elements in a compound bonded together. It can't be the same element bonded together. That would still be an element. So like an oxygen molecule over here that's just made up of just oxygen, that's still an element. But water is a compound because it's two or more different types of atoms bonded together. So elements and compounds, they're pretty simple in terms of types of matter. They're also collectively referred to as, let me get black again here, they're collectively referred to as pure substances. But there are two more different types of matter. And we're going to talk about them, for this class, we're going to kind of talk about them collectively. And they're called mixtures. I forgot my X. Mixtures. Let me write that again. There. And so the biggest thing about a mixture is that it's made up of two or more different substances that can be physically separated from each other. So the example that I love to use as a mixture is Kool-Aid. I'm not sure if you guys still drink Kool-Aid or not these days, but when I was a kid, we drank it all the time. To make Kool-Aid, you'd start with water, which is a compound, and then you'd get out this packet, and out of the packet, you'd pour this powder. And the powder would have pigment and flavor molecules in it. So have pigment and flavor molecules. And, you know, those would be compounds. The pigment would be a compound, and the flavor, whatever the substance was that made the flavor, would be a compound. One thing it did not have in it, and you'd be very sad if you didn't add it to it, was sugar. And so you'd get out your sugar, and you'd also add sugar into your Kool-Aid. So we'll make the yellow dots be sugar here in a little model that we're drawing. There. And so what would happen is you'd stir all this together, and then you get this glass of delicious or semi-delicious, depending on your opinion, liquid that would taste like cherry or fruit punch or grape or whatever flavor your parents had happened to buy for you. Now, if you could look at what was going on inside of that glass, what you would see is you would see water molecules, a lot of them. A lot of them, because Kool-Aid was mostly water. And then floating around inside of the water molecules, because you put them in there from the packet, there would be little pigment molecules, which were turning the whole thing red or purple or green or whatever flavor color Kool-Aid you happen to have. There'd be a matching flavor molecule, again, from the little packet that you added, and that would be causing it to taste like fruit punch or cherries or grapes or, you know, again, whatever flavor you had. And then so that kids liked it and it was sweet, you had added a whole bunch of sugar molecules in there as well. Now, I'm representing these molecules with dots, and they're actually not dots. They would be molecules made up out of atoms, things like carbon and hydrogen and stuff. But what you see here is that the Kool-Aid actually has a whole bunch of different substances in it. And the way that you can tell that it's a mixture is that you could, if you wanted to, you could take that glass of Kool-Aid and you could separate the substances back out, and you could do that physically. You can physically separate a mixture. And I can give you an example how you could physically get one of the substances out of a glass of Kool-Aid. And that substance is water. If you took your Kool-Aid and you put it in a pot, a pot on the stove, so here's my Kool-Aid, and I threw it in my pot on the stove. As you start to heat the pot, water has the lowest boiling point out of any of these substances over here. And so as you start to heat the pot, the water will change from a liquid in the Kool-Aid into a gas, and then it will travel off into the air. And if you do this long enough, all of the water is going to evaporate out of the Kool-Aid. It's still water, and it's going to leave the pigment, the flavor, and the sugar molecules behind. And so by boiling the water, what you've been able to do is physically separate your matter into different substances. You physically separated the water out of the rest of the matter, out of the rest of the Kool-Aid. And that's the key to identifying a mixture. If you can physically separate the components of it, then it's a mixture. So another example might be soil. Like if you went out to your backyard and you got some soil, one of the things that you could do, like if you had a bucket of dirt, basically, one of the things that you'll notice when you look at soil is that it's not all the same in there. There's different colors, and sometimes you'll have like maybe some rocks in there too, and it's not all the same stuff in there. And one of the things that you can do to separate those out is you could take that soil and you could pour it through some screens, and you could have like a set of progressively smaller screens that you could pour the soil through. And so what that would do is it would physically separate the substances in that matter, the soil. It would physically separate them based on their size. Another way that you can physically separate the stuff that's in soil based on its size is to dump the soil in some water and then stir it all up. And what happens is the heaviest things that are in the soil will settle out first. So if there's like some rocks and gravel in the soil, those settle out first to the bottom. And then what will happen is your soil will settle out in layers depending on how heavy it is. So like the sand would settle out next. And then the dirt might be on top of it. Right? And then maybe there was like some twigs or something that were floating on the very top of the water. But the key is, again, you can physically separate the soil. And so that means that it's a mixture. So there you go. You've got your three main types of matter that we're going to be looking at in this class. You can actually divide mixtures into two different types, but we'll save that for another lesson if you want to delve a little bit deeper. But just to sum up, you've got three main types of matter. You've got elements, and they're made up of all of the same type of atom. And then there are compounds like water, and compounds are made up of two or more different types, different elements bonded together. And then the third type of matter are called mixtures, and it's made up of two or more different substances that you can physically separate. So that's the end of this first online lesson. Thanks for watching. We'll talk to you soon.